and give us some food, nourishing food. See, you go anywhere and get food, but you can't go every place to get nourishing food, especially God's nourishing food. That's the only thing. And I just want to first of all thank Pastor Hogg for allowing us to be here tonight, opening up the doors tonight and tomorrow for this occasion. We're going to open up a prayer, and then we're going to turn the service over to Pastor Dedric, where he can do how he achieves.
Glory to God. I can't help myself. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, I just can't help myself. It's a privilege and an honor to be here tonight. And I'm so glad that this is our man of God here tonight. And I know it's going to be off the chain. Okay, let me do what I was called to do. I just can't help myself. But see, Pastor Hart knows me, so she said, be who you are. See, that's what I love, you know? Okay. Thank you. Father, we come thanking you for this night. Father, we come in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, we come to give you praise and worship and the glory, Lord God. But this is the day that you've made. Father, we come expecting to hear what you have to say to us this night, oh God. That it will fall on solid ground, oh God. That it will increase us in the things of you, oh God. I thank you for the ones that are on their way, God. That you will have a safe traveling for them, oh God. That when they get here, Father God, they'll be ready and expecting to hear also, God. We come tonight to celebrate you, Lord. I thank you for everyone that's seated here tonight, Lord. I give you praise, I worship you, and I adore you, God. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
This young man, I met recently myself. And I sat at his feet in fellowship and worship. I've spoken with him over the phone several times. Introduced him via the phone to Pastor Hart. I want you to open up your minds and your hearts, because this is not service ordinary, but it's service extraordinary. If you're open and you're willing to listen the message from God, you'll not walk out of here the same way you came in. I'd like to introduce you to apostle, author, prophet, Dedric. Let's have a standing.
Well, let me get this right. I don't know really how to work the music, so if anybody wants a little worship, I couldn't do both of them.
I'm multitasking, but I can't do all of that.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we come to praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. We want to give God some glory right now in the name of Jesus. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. I came to hear the word. I came to be nourished and fed. But right now, we want to take a charge of the atmosphere and worship and praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love to praise Him. I love to praise Him. I love to praise, I love to praise Him.
I love to praise His name. I love to praise His name.
Operate on your own. Because it's a money game, we really look at it. So
when they lose somebody, they lose money. And I was just looking at the news the other day, how the IRS backed up to George Miles. They want to know why she got $5,000 and ain't paying taxes. We ain't talking about a bump now, we talking about $1 million. But she ain't paying no taxes. So that within itself is showing that God is moving, because, you know, I can't find the scripture right now, but in that, you got to pay seeing what it is. So what we've done, we done took the gospel and we made these ministries and get these 501c3 and we get all the money and the sheep still stop. So we're going to go ahead and go to Ruth chapter 2. And many of you know, it's just familiar scripture. I think most people teach the book of Ruth as a book of hope and companionship and how she didn't know that, but she was willing to follow somebody. But see, tonight I'm a teacher. You need to know some before you follow anybody. Because the way I read Ruth, this is the best book to teach on manipulation. Because actually, she was manipulated. But because we look at people and think they have our best interest in heart, we follow them wholeheartedly without a relationship with God. So Ruth chapter 2, verse 1, it says, and Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a mighty man of wealth of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. First thing we got to know, what you are connected to can hinder you. Your job, your family, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife, all that can hinder you. So what we need to understand about Naomi is that Boaz was her kids. But when you read the story and go on through with it, what you got to think about, why did Ruth send Boaz, why did Naomi send Ruth to Boaz to get work, but that's her kids? Naturally, if we need some money, we go straight to the source. So number one, you got to realize, just because you're connected to somebody, don't mean you go do what you do. Because in my family, if I need the money, that's my cousin, why am I sending a representative? First thing first, manipulation. Why? Because if you go to your kinsmen to get something from them, they might have to get you because they know you. He didn't know her. So what you got to realize is, does your connection match your position? Which means in this season, does who you are connected to now, does it represent where God is taking you? See, a lot of people holler, shift this, shift that, but you have no direction, no instruction. You have no anointing, no power. So the man and the prophet come in and holler, shift, everybody wants to jump and clap their hands. God is a God of order. Stop clapping that shit. But God, what are we shifting to? Like in this season, we have to shift. We shifting us back because we miss some things in this Bible. We miss some things in operating in what we call Christian. We miss some things because we went away from the soul and we went for the pride. We went for the popularity. We went for the money. So now we got people that got the gift of gab preaching, killing the sheep. Why? Because they don't know who they are. They ain't got no anointing. They ain't got no power. They paying tithes, still hungry. But when they go to the church, what it is, we ain't got it. Let me see your prayer report. You know, go over there to the camp. What they gonna say? Same name right here. So why is it as Christians, we giving all our money to these churches, but we gotta go outside to get help?
Yeah.
I was talking to a guy the other day, you know, he talking about how good his pastor and all that. So why you even having me for money? That's your man or woman of God. You say they all powerful. Why they can't meet your need? See what's happening. You know what I mean? Men and sheep don't prove their needs. You got to know who's laboring among them. So So if I call you and tell you that you hungry, you need some gas money, what do your knee pain do? You go to church because the clocks ain't good. You might see a woman or man who wants to come to you, or you know, it's a mega church, so we want to be known, so we go to the TD Jake church. But then we look at it, and many people join churches without questioning God, should I go here? So what happens, we begin to like the teaching, we like the fellowship, but we're sitting there now. Certain things, does your reputation qualify your credentials? How do you know God so? You're going to see many opportunities in this year. Which means they're going to see you growing, they see you moving. Let me come over there and say something to them.
Can't hear you back there. Okay,
it's better.
Yes. Yeah.
All right, so you're going to see a lot of opportunities.
Thank you.
Opportunities are people who want to use you to get to the next level. So once they get to their level, they forget about you.
Mm.
You know? It's like starting a ministry in the house. Girl, call me at any time of night. You can always come over here. You get your 30 and 40 numbers, but you need to make a point. You just can't come over my house no more. You know, I was talking to a girl before Crypto Dollar started. Gave her all his money when they started the thing. He got that big old bill and jumped out. So you gave her all your money. Then we look at it down the holding field. $23 million, tied. He got in trouble, what he got? Nothing. So, we got to realize, you got to get your own relationship with God. We just can't go hear anybody because it sounds good. We got to go and seek this thing out for ourselves, because what happens, we get in a place that you do know you're responsible for what you don't know. Even the law tells you, you know, there's no ignorance or excuse of the law, which means you're supposed to know the law. God gonna hold you accountable for not knowing what your gift is. He gonna hold you accountable for not knowing where to go to get your gift trained, to get empowered, to know what your calling is in God. Third thing is, what have you heard, or are you connected by default? Which means, a lot of people, when I started my ministry, I didn't know nothing. I'm driving a truck, picking up scrap, making plenty of money, because I was stealing. Cheap. I was doing down, they call it. But I was okay. But what happened is that I began to get a conscience about what I did. You know, I didn't send them the stuff because I was eating the hollow scrap for all the Salvation Armies in Birmingham. It's going to be splitting the money. I make three trips, they get half of one, I get two and a half. Then whatever I liked, I kept and sold. Then I got the washing and drives, fixed them, and sold them. So I'm making all this money. Every time I go in there, this is all we give, yeah. So what happens, the reputation I seen in myself, God said, well, let me use his wisdom in business and finance and how to get over and to teaching his gospel. So the way I teach to make people better. Don't just clap and say you preach the power, you sure know the right problem. It's just speaking to your spirit. See, we get caught up in things that sound good, but it has no spiritual foundation. You know, when they say love the sinner, hate the sin. Alright? What the Bible say? What do you get in Solomon Gomorrah? He didn't take the sin apart. He killed the sin and the person. So why can you teach people that? And what you're doing, that's a fail saying, but God ain't through me yet. God know my heart. What the Bible say, your heart empty. Go to clapping, but it has no spirit for me. We're missing God. Back to the basics. Which means God is raising up people saying, hey, that ain't what that means. This is what this means. But now we got people that been preaching 20, 30 years. They can't take the truth because now that five revelation they got, it can't be wrong because I hear God. Ain't that wrong with some God in mission? I did plenty of the time. I learned when you in ministry, you forever learn. You're going to miss it sometime. It's prideful not to say, hey God, I miss you. Go on. Verse 2, and Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me now go to the field and glean ears of corn after him whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, go, my daughter. Second thing is preparation. Preparation always began with separation. When God prepared me for ministry, I was in this church. I was cutting, I was talking about a well. I was cutting grass, get $1,000 a month. I like the people. God said, God was calling me into the prophetic. I went to the pastor. Pastor said, I can't help you. So watch this. He don't want me to leave the church. So why should I stay here? He can't help me. Okay. Making money, $1,000, I ain't going nowhere. But when God turned that church over, well, he a devil. He got a demon in him. He crazy. I had to go. Why? Because that spirit of familiarity wanted me to stay there, and then I'm getting money. You know, $1,000 a month, that's a lot of money. 30 minutes go to work around a church. So it's money. But then I had to leave. So beginning my ministry, I understood then that God took me a process that he had to separate me to be who I am. I had to be different. So I'm getting these new revelations. God telling me stuff. I go, that ain't God. God don't say that. That ain't God. Because when you have a trailblazer anointing, that means you got to sit you by yourself because you got to pay away that and never get paid. God took me out of Birmingham and sent me in Atlanta, my ministry took off. I had a website and a Ustream account, all of them free. Sitting there on my porch, on my balcony, preaching bold. All of a sudden, email, phone call, people crying. God been telling me that for years, you just sitting there preaching this so bold. So you got to understand, when God speaks to you to say something, you know who you are, God, just say it, people coming. So watch this. This old black woman from Birmingham, nobody knew. Now they call her from Canada, Turkey, Dubai, all the other names I can't pronounce, asking me questions. And I'm telling them the answer. And what they and the common theme is, God told me that 5 years ago. God told me that 10 years ago. But nobody was bold enough to say it. Okay? Alright. So that's what God wanted me to do. That's all I needed to know. So everything I heard, I spoke. But then you hear deliverance of the people on a little bit of website. Every day, I'm probably doing 3-4 videos, they would ever tell me to say, I'm saying, look, I'm saying it, say this. What God have told you and you ain't told me about? What revelation that you got that you supposed to believe you're sitting on that? What's the problem? People waiting on some of you, but you waiting on somebody to confirm what you need is God. God speaks to us any different. I teach the people in Florida, you know, this is my saying, I said, we go to heaven in individual rate, not group rate. So don't rely on me to know everything about you. When God tell you something, you do. Why? Because you responsible for what you say when you talk good enough, you know it's God, you better say it. Because you responsible for the people assigned to hear your voice, now you behind, you got other people behind. And a lot of y'all ain't them behind. That's what we worry about. Money. Are they going to talk to a girl in the office? I said, why you ain't missionary? I'm scared to fail. All right, you ain't ready for ministry. But that done on social media, that's a different church. A logo and a ministry page, automatically, you the prophet of the day. You the apostle of the day. But then, what people fail to realize, when you release revelation, you know you're responsible for having somewhere to take those people to teach what you preach. But what's wrong with social media is that everybody ain't the same. So some of you listen to people that are more advanced than you because your pastor don't know anything about it. That ain't God. So now, your spirit torn. You listen to somebody else who's hearing God, but you're going to a place that don't even know the God in you. Dead, spiritually dead, religion. So now you're sitting there, thinking, as long as you're paying your tithe, pastor got you covered. Leave spelling this evening. I tell people, you can tell a person they ain't paying tithe, they ain't coming to church, but you can't call and say, hey, God said you're going through it, this is what you're going through. I was telling somebody the other day, it might not sound right. You can't tell me. him on the Spirit of the Father, he can get more blood for that long. You can't tell. You mean, you supposed to be over this man, you all this spiritual highs, this man over here sex and boys, and your spirit to tell you that? Years. So when people come to you for help, you need to prove who your leader is. The Bible said they watch over your soul. So the same way you say I ain't tired, you're supposed to tell me what I'm in. So now, as long as I'm tired, I can see it all I want. We got to realize that we don't get to a point that we knew God for ourselves. How do we know we're going to heaven? Somebody try to, a lot of times I don't tell people I preach, I'm just down to earth. I'm gonna go to, I guess you call yourself trying to, what you call evangelize to? You're going to heaven when you die? I said, I don't know. Ain't you Jesus your Lord and Savior? I said, yeah. Why you ain't going to heaven? I don't know what I'll do between now and then. I don't know when I'm gonna fall. How can I say, just because I go to church, I'm going to heaven? Is in church, so we understand some of some of the leaders ain't going. But the fact of the matter is that my prayer to God, as long as when I save one person to hell, from hell, and they go to heaven, I go. I'm tormented, but that's the only thing I'm thinking about. At least I save somebody else. You don't know when you're going to heaven. You don't know when you gonna fall. I had a pastor to say, you don't know when the right one gonna come along. We walk around here like we spiritual tough. It's the right one out there for you. And as soon as you die down, that's when you get it. So, first thing, desperation. Who or what are you trying to prove yourself to? I tell people all the time, I ain't in competition with nobody. God told me what I was called to do. I do what I call to do, and as a result, people started following me. I didn't know anything about ministry. All I heard was God's voice. First ministry with the Tallahassee a couple of years ago. I built a second website. Within 3 days, the number one website, the federal website in the world. So imagine how many people was coming to hear when I had said, that's all was nosy. And when God allowed me to see it, he said, see where you came from? Watch this now. I had no ministry in training. All I had was I didn't have no overseer. All I had was no. So when I got to that, he said, that's what I want you to do. You take an ordinary person, teach them who they are, and watch me grow. Why do we have to prove who we are? And what gets me, in the Bible says, one faith, one baptism, one Lord. If I'm licensed and ordained at this church, why I gotta get licensed and ordained somewhere else? One Lord, one faith, one baptism. What is that? So their license, a name, more important than where you came from? Other things should matter. Do you know how to operate a ministry? And are you ready? One Lord, one faith. So why do you have to continue to prove who you are in God over and over again? You know what? People jealous. I had a leader one time. She was big about, I ain't jealous of your gift. God got me all that. Mess around and hear God for yourself. She won't even talk to you no more. This is a leader that'll bring a person in the, I don't know where they get this from. They'll bring a person in the house, preach a word, and when they leave, talk about it. They ain't anointed. That ain't God. And I'm looking, I said, don't she know what she's saying? Well, why is she in here preaching on your sheep? What that mean? Pride. Everybody want to be the head in charge. Ain't nobody more knowing than me. But when you look at the Bible, and you look at how the disciples were, they had a disagreement for everybody to come together.
desperation. So what we do? We'll slip past $100. Why? Because I won't be noticed. Yeah. Well, let me go buy pounds and shoes and a suit. Why? Desperate. But sooner or later, let me bring them up to preach, because they sure is a good deal. Y'all buying people to notice who you are. Jesus was a cop with a billion foundation like I did. That's not how I manage a website and an overgrown checking account. You don't need no money, all you need is this. Hear what God telling you. So what's wrong? The fear of the unknown separates you and your seed. Many of y'all have passed y'all seed because you were scared. Well, I want to get out there. Is people going to come listen to me? Is the church going to be figured out? I hope I have a good offer. Fear of the unknown. So you scared to step out in faith to prove to God that you hear him, because you need somebody to confirm who you are. You already confirmed when you hear his voice. He'll authorize you. People look at me and they get mad. Well, how do you go here, and I see him doing this and that. When you're knowing about God, you don't have to struggle. You can give. All you got to do is listen. That was my first bill. Well, shoot, I ain't got no money. I have to do ministry. It was 4 years before anybody started giving me something. But everything I was using for free, I never get it. Pick it off. 4 years ago. Now I look around. 300. 500. 1,000. One guy sells stocks. He'll give me the profit. Because he believed it. What I'm saying, a lot of y'all are scared. When you come to a place of God that you hear him for yourself, you're the most dangerous weapon in the church. I tell you, a sheep that hear God's voice for themselves, you're a threat to some people. Why? Because now they know you ain't no fool. Now they know. It kills me. 2 years ago, I was talking to this girl. We was talking about leadership. And it saddened me for somebody to say, it's easier for me to go to the pastor and see what God said. It's easier for me to go to the pastor and see what God said. I said, you don't pray for yourself? No, I just go to him. I feel I'm too busy. I shake my head. But you couldn't tell him that. Third thing, who's giving you permission to perform? Like I say, social media is killing the church. All of a sudden, I call them Barabbas ministers. I mean, they make a lot of noise, they draw people, and if people tell the truth, they don't even hear. So what's happening now? They've got to deal with gab. They know how to talk. They con artists in the pulpit, making a lot of noise, got big churches. You don't know who you are. All you got is a chicken frying committee over in the parking lot. And you got to realize, singing in the choir ain't serving God, that's serving the church. That ain't your gift. That's your gift to the local assembly, but that ain't what God wants you, you know, wants you to be. So when I say who's giving you permission to form, did God, did you actually have an experience with God, or did you have an experience with your emotions? I was talking to this girl a couple of months ago, and she finally said she in ministry because she's jealous of what I was doing in ministry. So now, you bought TV time on radio, on TV. You out there evangelizing, and the reason you do it because you seen me and was jealous of me, and God ain't told her. Now she out of her mind. The spirit of mimicking is killing the church. What Corinthians says, you know, dare not compare yourself with themselves, of themselves. We mimic people. Everybody want to dress like Jamal Brown. Everybody want to teach about prosperity. And it's in the church. Who teaches gift? What's your gift? What's your calling? What's your anointing? How you under leadership for 20 years and the pastor never pulled you in the office and say, hey, this is what God called you to do. This is how I'm going to help you. We missed God somewhere. We got to go back. Verse 3. And she went and came and gleaned in the field after a reaper, and that half was too light on a part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the kindred of Elimelech. And this is where it gets tricky. Does your position match your mission? Which means, are you in position to receive what God has for you? Are you in position to be taught who you are in God? Are you in position to know when you're being manipulated? Let's go to Leviticus 19. Leviticus 19, we're going to start at verse 9. This is how we're going to tie this in. And when you reap the harvest of your land, thou shalt not wholly reap the corners of thy field. Neither shalt thou gather the gleanings of thy harvest, and thou shalt not glean thy vineyard, neither shalt thou gather every grain of thy vineyard. Thou shalt leave them for the poor and the stranger. I am the Lord your God. So what does that mean? Ruth, because she didn't know God for herself, she was working for something wrong with her. The Bible says that you shouldn't reap the whole harvest of the field. So why was Ruth have light on the field belonging to Boaz? Boaz reaped the whole field, which means he's supposed to left that for the stranger. So why was Ruth in there working for something? It was already on her, so it's going to the Bible. You know why? She didn't have a relationship with God. She didn't know the law. So what that mean? A lot of you, because you don't have a relationship with God, you manipulate out your money. You manipulate out your knowing. Men tricking you out your pants. Laying in your house playing video games ain't working. And we walk around wondering, well, God, why I'm in this. If God don't talk back to you and wonder why you're in that, that means you don't have no relationship. Because anytime I get in trouble, Lord, why this happened? Because you did such and such. Why we can't hear God for himself? So have means look, change, or an occurrence, which means she on a rich man's land that's supposed to leave stuff for the stranger, and she coming up short. Just because you under leadership or in a ministry that preaches good, don't mean it's good, buddy. When we talk about the kingdom, and it's different between kingdom and church. Church has bylaws, rules, and obligations. Kingdom has obedience, blessing, and sacrifice. Which means you hear, you do, and you get. You go to church, I was in this one church. This man had this church like a Orthodox. You had to witness to 10 people. And the 10 people had to join the church. You had to bring accountability for them. You couldn't miss Bible study. You couldn't miss looking. Look at it. How can I control if somebody liked my church? So you're telling me, if I don't get 10 people to join this church, then I can't give my life to the preacher. People do some silly stuff around here.
So when I said
your effort, why are you doing what you're doing? Are you doing ministry just to be seen? You doing it to gain a crowd. You're doing it to say, hey, I preach. Because we don't preach for souls no more. We preach for popularity. It's competition. We got on the Shabbat suit, the Shabbat robe, the fast gales, the shortest skirt. We ain't got souls no more. We got to get back to the souls. It's about the soul. So now, you know, church in the uproar, the gang. But why entertaining on the keyboard in the choir stand, you know, on the praise team, and now you get mad because they got their rights? If you preach the gospel, they should be comfortable standing in that thing. You preach the gospel right now, I want to join the worship team. Why? The Bible says abomination. When you look over abomination, you bring abomination to yourself. But watch this, why get mad? What they got to do with you? You follow God. He already told them what the world gonna do. Why get mad? Because we don't know who we are, we need to find something for us about. We need to get on the bandwagon. Third thing in your position, lack. Why aren't you growing? And what you missing? A lot of people do not have spiritually trained members. I seen some on the website for $149.95, you can be a licensed ordained bishop if you take the test. You can go to school, spend $20,000 to $30,000, get your doctor of divinity. What's all that? It ain't going nowhere then. It ain't about the soul no more. What we realize and what I tell people, what it is now, church is a circus and Jesus is a sideshow free. Let me show you Jesus any kind of way, you won't pay for it. People standing on chairs, pulling people over, talking about they laying hands and prophesying. That ain't no Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit gentle. God. Calling people up to the front. You'll see you're thinking God not. Why you embarrassing people in the church? That ain't God. God don't embarrass us outright like that. He talked to us first. But even then, you can sit here and everybody know you're saying, now you're embarrassed, don't want to come to church no more. But you. The reason I'm so successful most of the time, I tell people, what you do if you sin it, is between you and God. My job is to pull out what God put in you. Now, if I say something about a sin and teach on it, I said, be warned, he may be talking to you. I don't care what you do, that's between you and him. I can't stop you. I can't send you to hell. That's your choice. You do it. But if you even talk about sleeping around, if you even talk about lying, that means get ready, you're ready to work on it. I stayed in the house for a whole year when God first called me because I avoided what I was in. Lord and women, had him. Whole year. Well, not a whole year. December the 12th. Boy, you ain't delivered, you hide. That's what you said? Holy Spirit said, you ain't delivered, you hide. You deliver when you can go back into it and don't bother you. I'm going grocery shopping at night, going to the mall, tying it over because I know what I want and the method out, I'm grabbing it, come back out. Because I don't want to see the short skirts. I don't want to see all the breasts all out. I'm going back and home. A lot of us, we will our own self to live. I'm going to strip club, get chicken wings. Don't bother me now. Shit all they want. You never know what God sent you back to get something from, so you got to make sure you deliver.
Amen.
So a lot of us then willed ourselves deliver, avoiding what we think we deliver from, and wonder why every time there's a different other call, we get all happy. Disappointment. Who you judging? Why you tired? A lot of people tired of ministry. You done gave all your money, you done gave all your time, the ministry ain't growing, I'm just going to sit here and wait my time and die. We got to get a fresh fire back. What we fail to realize in ministry, even when I learned this, God will give you a vision for ministry. But if God sees something wrong and something ain't going to happen, God will send you somebody to change your vision. I'm down in Florida trying to help this guy. I said, hey, you need to start operating your ministry like that. He stopped calling me. Now he lost the church. Didn't want to listen. Well, God gave you this vision. That's what I'm sticking to. Sometimes people don't hear God. So if people don't hear God, don't do what they're supposed to do for your ministry, then God will have to send you somewhere else to get what you need. There's plenty of places I know God told people to give me something. And they didn't give it to me. I didn't say that. But go over here and do this. Boom. You got it. So look what I'm saying. A lot of you, God may have gave a vision for your ministry. But he want to change it. Why does he want to change? Because we going backwards to teach people how to come forward now. You know, we can't allow people to sit on the pews. And what I teach people, if you're around me and God don't give me a word for you, you ain't called me. I don't just let people sit there and give me. You're not called to me, or you ain't called to me yet. So I call that a dead seat. Don't just sit there like, because you like the way I may preach one day, and you like going around. And that was wrong with a lot of churches. Believe it or even hear God for somebody, but because we like it, and they good pays, we let them sit there. This problem. So a lot of us have. I met so many people. Burnt out on giving. Burnt out on living. Burnt out on ministry. Because the people that they trusted the most manipulated. But both, I don't know how they, but when you grow up in the hood, you can't manipulate them. We curse them right in front of the police. You know, we constantly looking around and we know you want to break it out. You know, so if I bring something in or call something, I'm bringing it in, I'm leaving it in the car, so I know everybody's asleep in the house. We something else. We all want to work in. You might as well bring it on up. As long as we as black people see things as black and white, we ain't getting to heaven. Everybody's DNA came from black people. That's not racism. That's Satan causing division, because if black and white ever get together, we something else. First time God told me to move, I went to Omaha. I went to Omaha to preach for a week. I said, ooh, I like up here. He said, well, you want to move? I said, man, I ain't got no money. Pray for it. White people went and got me an apartment, put the furniture in there. It wasn't what I like. You know, we got different things. But it was furniture. And put food in the refrigerator. Here you go, D. Pay your bills. White people. Homeless ones that have nowhere to go. White people. Black and white people, we the same. But we don't see that spirit of division that keeps us from really embracing one another. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're different. Two white children, they can be the same. I'm like, oh, man, you all know. And really, ooh, they ain't got no knowing they preach, but they know how to dissect the word. Look, I'm saying this is that. Watch this. You can't follow racism and follow civil rights and follow that. You know why? Forgiveness. Everything you bring it up, that's how we get. So people get mad at it, but it's the truth. Watch this. When the Bible teaches God don't force his will on us,
nope.
You know what God is in trouble? You're going to start with. Why had to feed another man's cattle. I stayed in Birmingham. Grandmama said, before civil rights, we stayed on that side, they stayed on that side, and we was fine.
Got up sooner or later, God brought somebody else with a fresh idea.
Moses time was. But watch this. That's how we kill the church. You can't go no higher than me. Did Joshua go follow the Lord? What? Did Jesus tell the disciples greater work you gonna do? Those Bible say tonight, robbery to be even with. So how can you sit there and listen to somebody tell you can't go no higher than him? He living in you. You gotta know how people preach. They preach in two ways. Superiority and inferiority. Inferiority means they teaching you like you dumb and you think they know everything. No, they know what Greek and Hebrew mean. They know what this number mean. That don't mean they better than you. Church was designed to empower the people to do the work of the ministry. It wasn't a power for you to sit here year after year, year after year, I got to go get fed. Watch the animals. Eating the birds, kick them out the neck. Eating the pigs, clip them off the tip. Why we got to be fed? When you gonna go from powdered milk to junk food? Don't taste good, just that you got that applesauce. Hey, we got to grow up. Because what's happening, like I said, we're going back to the base, which means, if I really sense it, I know it. God is raising up people that align the spirit, and they don't care about no position. All they care about, this is what God's saying, this is what you got to do. People try to get us back, hey, we done messed up. Authority. What's other authority? Oh, y'all from the Hayfield. If you in it, you'll be all right when you do it. When you sit around and allow people to claim you as spiritual children, and you call yourself a spiritual parent, you don't understand the spirit. What happens is that you create a doorway for some deal and that generation curse to get yours. So what happened, you may be through with your struggle, but because you got a spiritual parent, guess what? You gotta get that struggle. That's why God, Jesus said, don't call no man father. Look at Timothy. Remember the chapter, I know it's in there. By the way, I got short term memory, but I know it's in there, let's see. Paul called Timothy, the spiritual son, up to a point. He called him a co-label and brother in the gospel. Now, shouldn't that tell you that was unnatural? Because he got a revelation somewhere. This boy ain't my son. This is my co-label in the gospel. This is my brother. So what happened? You are always a spiritual son, and they never see you as they do. Why? Because they've been preaching long to you. Number two, if it's unnatural, naturally, it's unnatural spirit. How can a 40-year-old person call a 30-some-year-old my spiritual father? That's unnatural. It goes against the word of God. Alright? What's supposed to be in that age range, right? The Bible still says a little deeper than the whole load. So if it's wrong on that means wrong by the court. So what's happening with a lot of us? We're not growing and we're struggling because we believe in something that's not scripture. You gotta go back to the basics. What's wrong with being a person mentor? What's wrong with being a person brother? So when they come to me, they use old saying and all that. I say, well, I don't like all that. I say, we mentor, we gonna do this together. Now, you bring something to the table, I'm gonna bring something. Because